Good morning, everyone. I want to thank Thomas Debes for inviting me. And I've been here before, but this is probably the first time I think we are talking about the refugee issues. As some of you have been reading the newspaper lately, every day almost we see the refugee crisis. And the response in some places are not what we expected. But before I do that, I wanted to share with you in terms of the refugee connection to the diaspora community. When we call people diaspora, actually at one time they were refugees also. So the transition from a refugee to diaspora to citizenship is a process that we have been doing in this country probably for more than 200 something years. My organization, the U.S. Committee for Refugee and Migrant, has been in existence since 1911. I'm not a founding member, but we have been resettling and supporting immigrants coming into this country since that time. I'm sure there are some organizations who have been doing this work before we do. 10 years ago, if some of you remember, there were about 38 million refugees, according to the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. 38 million, that's 10 years ago. Right now, according to the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, there are about 60 million refugees. You know, about 86% of these refugees are actually worldwide, are hosted by developing countries. Pakistan, Iran, Kenya has refugees since 1991 in the Dadaab refugee camp. More than 500,000 Somalis are still in refugee camp. Sudan is hosting Eritrean refugees. Some of them have been there since 1964. So, you know, most of refugees that we hear recently in Europe are probably new to the European countries in terms of the modern refugee flow, but some developing countries has been actually helping refugees and resettling refugees for many, many years. If the number of people today who are either refugee or internally displaced, we call them IDPs, or seek asylum, where the population of a country, it would be the 24th largest country in the world. Imagine if we add all those numbers, you know, we'll have 60 million people, and that would make refugees as a country was 24th the largest country in the world. Recently, more than 500,000 refugees have arrived in Europe so far. This year, as many as 1 million may have entered by year's end. You know, in the U.S. resettlement program, you know, in 2015, we resettled about 70,000 refugees. We actually averaged 70,000 refugees. And since 1975, the U.S. refugee resettlement program resettled more than 3 million refugees. I'm not adding asylees, and as you heard it, the Cuban American community in Miami-Dade County. Without adding that number, we have resettled over 3 million refugees in this country. Before the conflict, the current conflict in Syria started, in fact, Syria was the second largest refugee hosting country with 2 million refugees. Just recently, the Syrian civil war has currently produced over 4 million Syrian refugees and 7.6 million internally displaced people. Just one country, a country that has been actually welcoming refugees for many years and hosts over 2 million refugees now are, you know, becoming refugees, and 4 million of them are actually out of the country. Turkey is hosting 1.9 million Syrian refugees. And the good thing about the Turkish resettlement program is most of them are not actually in refugee camp. They have been given a permission to work, to go to school. They have been provided basic services. So that's another model I think countries need to continue. Jordan, a very small country, is hosting 2.6 million refugees. 2.6 million refugees. And surprisingly, a small country like Lebanon, which is 4 million people, is actually hosting about Lebanon is hosting about 1.1 million, which is about 25% of their population is as refugees. So in the U.S., as I said, you know, we hosted, we resettled about 3 million refugees, but at the same time, for the Syrian refugees, I believe since the conflict started, we resettled about 2,000. We believe that the U.S., as always, has to take a leadership role when it comes to the refugee crisis, whether it's the Syrian crisis or the crisis of other places in Africa and Asia. We believe that we can actually provide more services and we can admit more refugees to this country out of the Syrian crisis. And we believe that that's really a humanitarian thing. And I think the U.S. Has been always a leader when it comes to refugee resettlement. We believe that, you know, a humanitarian concern of every refugee, regardless of their ethnicity, regardless of their religion, regardless of where they come from, should be given the protection they deserve. We have granted 500,000 people asylum in many years. At the same time, you know, we have given a TPS status for Syrians. This is a temporary protected status for Syrians who have been in this country already as either as a student or as a tourist. The refugee diaspora has a role to play. If we have 3 million refugees being resettled since 1975, most of them are actually U.S. citizens. We have went through that process. We have seen the challenges. We have seen the difficulty of being refugees and living in a refugee camp for many, many years. I think we have a role to play in welcoming refugees, assisting refugees, and providing service to refugees. Unfortunately, sometimes the Diaspora community did forget that, you know, we have that history and we have a certain role and responsibility when it comes to advocating on behalf of refugees. I urge you to become the voice for the voiceless, regardless of where you came from. Every refugee should see himself through other refugees, and that's the principle I believe that will be helping us. Unfortunately, this day is the only person who's talking about mostly about refugees is the Pope. Thank God he's talking about it. But a lot of people have been quite silent. Martin Luther King once said, in the end, we will be remembered not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Friends, we cannot afford to be silent when it comes to a refugee crisis. Thank you very much.